Harry Carabina in St. Louis, Harry Carey's broadcasting career began in 1941 at radio station WCLS in Joliet. After a brief stint in Kalamazoo, Harry moved back home to St. Louis in 1945, where he called Cardinal games for 25 years.
Get him out! High pop ball! The ball is there! The Cardinals won the pennant!
Harry left St. Louis after a clash with Cardinal ownership and then spent 1 year calling Oakland A's games. In 71, he made the move to Chicago, first to the South Side, though, where he spent a dozen years
with
the White Sox.
Hello, Harry Carey from Comiskey Park, where the Chicago White Sox opened a two-game series against the Cleveland Indians.
Harry was known as the mayor of Rush Street, and he became as big a show as the game on the field, his personality matching perfectly with White Sox owner Bill Veeck, who bought the club in 75. For both men, baseball was all about having fun.
Oh, this is remarkable.
Look at this. Get there. I got it.
In 82, Carey pulled a surprising crosstown switch and began calling Wrigley Field home. Two seasons later with Harry at the mic, the Cubs did something they hadn't done in 39 years. Make it to the postseason. His health first became an issue in 87 when he suffered a stroke before the baseball season. But Harry returned to the broadcast booth in May as good as ever.
Let's play ball.
Through over 8,000 games, Harry Carey never stopped being a fan of the game. Always calling the action with the fans in mind and never afraid to laugh at himself.
Is that my name backwards?
Sanchez. He never dropped one of those in his life.
One. Just did.
He did. Holy cow. How about that?
I gotta talk again about it. Whoa, what happened?
Well, just another tragic booth accident.
$87 billion corporation and can't afford a better screen.
In 1989, Harry Carey capped a legendary career by being elected into the Baseball Hall of Fame.
My wife, Dutchie, thanks you. Our children all thank you. And from the very, very bottom of my heart, I thank you. Thank you very much.
Harry Carey shared the booth with both presidents and first ladies, but there was never any question that he was the king of Wrigley Field.